Can you talk about this mission being open-ended? I'm not as big of a geek as Brian, but I've read everything that is available to a lay person, and I've seen everything that's been created, documentaries, and it's really only in the sci-fi that things have an open-ended feel. How is this mission open-ended, and what's the purpose of that?
Well, ideally, we'd like to use the crew time while they're up there on board the space station. With Chris Cassidy being the only U.S. crew member up on board the station, we are getting a lot less science done as a solo guy. Mm. But having additional people on board will benefit that. But the primary mission is the test flight. And so we've got to get them up and back down. And we see how the vehicle handles while it's on orbit. So they're going to have to be pretty flexible about how long the mission is going to be. And these guys are. They're both, pretty laid back guys, and they can handle this flexibility, not knowing exactly when the mission will end. So it won't be a problem to them, I don't think.
Peggy, there's no a polite way to put my question to you, and that is that those of us who are old enough to have been around and alive and aware during what will always be known as the space race with then the Soviets have found it a little tough to take that for almost a decade, they've been our ride. There's been no other way to get Americans up to the magnificent International Space Station. And I'll take this opportunity to remind especially parents of little kids, sign up for Spot the Station on your phone. When it flies over your zip code, you'll get an alert. And it's one of the most exciting things to do on a clear night. But Peggy, it must feel good to finally have a homegrown ride to space.
Well, it is an extremely important factor. I mean, NASA is all about having redundancies, and right now we don't have one. And so that's put us at a huge disadvantage. It helped us having those redundancies, you know, post-Columbia. We were down 2 years before we got the shuttle up and flying again. And having that redundancy of having the Soyuz there to launch our crews enabled us to continue the space station. The construction dropped off dramatically, obviously, because we didn't have the shuttle carrying up the pieces and parts to build it. But space station and our crews going to orbit survived that. And the redundancy was important. And I feel personally that the redundancy it needs to include more than just SpaceX. We need more capability here from the United States. We always want to have that redundancy. And I think, you know, for future commercialization of space, it is going to be necessary to have more and more people taking folks to orbit in order to keep that interest and keep exploration moving forward.
We're also joined by another veteran of the space program, astronaut Clayton Anderson, a veteran of 167 days in space, including a good chunk of time on board the International Space Station and a good chunk of time out in the middle of nowhere, though tethered, walking in space and doing external missions. Clayton, same question I had for Peggy. Were you ever part of a launch that was scrubbed, so hurry up to only be delayed?
Amazingly enough, Brian, and by the way, it's great to see you again. Nothing was scrubbed. Every single launch that was associated with my time in 2007 went off exactly on time. Every single one.
Hmm. Wow. I wonder if you could work for Amtrak.
I'm blessed. Yeah.
Clayton, again, this is a terribly complex issue for you, but just for us lay people, talk about how different this is as a sight to behold there at the Cape, compared to the girth of the Saturn V, compared to the girth of the solid rocket boosters that we came to know as iconically representing the shuttle program. This could not be more different. It looks like if Tesla designed a spacesuit, this would be it. And indeed, they've been called stormtroopers. It's a lot to get used to.
Well, it's, you know, when I climbed on the shuttle, I guess it's kind of like me climbing into a 1972 pickup truck, and they climbed today into a Tesla 2020 Roadster. So the upgrades in technology, I certainly hope, made their training easier, makes their procedures easier, and makes it easier for them to deal with issues should any arise as they're going uphill. So I'm very excited for them. And going again Saturday, I sure hope they get a shot to play with the toys.
Clayton, is there any difference between heading into space on an Elon Musk associated mission and the kinds of missions that you were involved in? Is there any sort of, does one represent the future? Does his personality change anything about the experience, do you think?
Yeah, I think so. I think that Elon Musk is a guy that I would never bet against. And I think that he brings a nice aggressiveness to the situation, to the development, to the, he pushes to be aggressive and do new things. And, you know, a government organization like NASA, we were more slow and we plodded along occasionally. And we had a lot of hoops to jump through. And I think a guy like Elon with as a commercial company, he doesn't have to jump through as many hoops and he can make things happen faster. Of course, safety is always a concern, but I think that he understands that very well. And the buttons that he's pushing are the right buttons for commercialization.
Hey there, I'm Chris Hayes from MSNBC. Thanks for watching MSNBC on YouTube. If you want to keep up to date with the videos we're putting out, you can click subscribe just below me or click over on this list to see lots of other great videos.